Hello there, I'm MountPain27, and this is Dean of Doom, the show we give grades to classic and contemporary Doom wads. Why? Because ranking things is fun. Today's episode will be dedicated to Valiant, a megawad by Skillsaw released in 2015. I run the risk of having this dubbed the Season of Skillsaw after the Ancient Aliens and Vanguard episodes, as well as spotlighting him in BTSX1 and Eviternity, but frankly I could give a damn, because it's my show and he's my favorite. My elevator pitch for Valiant is this. It's the first Skillsaw wad I ever played, and when I finished it, I said, well, now I have to play everything this guy's ever done. And then I did. Well, not Hanging Gardens that almost fried my computer, but pretty much everything else. Anyway, Valiant gets its name from the chemical weapon described by the in-game text as capable of rewiring and rewriting genetic sequences more times than a failed writer's most pretentious manuscript. Only you stand in the way of a bioengineered, cybernetic apocalypse. Valiant is known less for its plot than for its modifications to Vanilla Doom's weapons and monsters. Skillsaw's changes are numerous, but the final product is... well, John Romero said it best.
Such a bigger, badder, better version of Doom.
Now, before we dive in, here's how the show works. We give each level in the WAD two grades, one for quality and one for difficulty. We grade quality from A to F, and difficulty from X to E. X for extreme, E for easy, and A through D in between. A grade A level is fun, memorable, visually distinctive, creative, and a fair challenge. Lower grades indicate the level lacks some or all of these qualities. Bear in mind that my Doom skills are far from elite, and I write these reviews out of love and a desire to entertain, but I'm only human. So our definitions of difficulty and great map design will surely differ. Disagreeing is part of the fun, after all. That said, if you think Valiant's level design is bad, you're wrong. At the end of the day, this show is about spreading the joy of Doom, so let's do so. For the new viewers in the audience, here are the rules. 1. We play on ultraviolence. 2. We play each level from a pistol start. 3. In order to review the WAD, I must have played it at least twice. 4. Saves are allowed, but discouraged. And 5. I go for 100% kills in all levels, making exceptions in cases where it's just not worth it. I play on Z-Doom, with compatibility settings on strict. Now, to the WAD. Map 1. Bad reception. In Valiant, everything is super. Your super pistol has nearly double its normal rate of fire, which is good because these super imps crank out fast-moving projectiles in twos, and these super pinkies can bite you faster when they get up close. The visuals are also super. The vegetation, tufts of grass, and cozy cavern textures set up the first episode's earthy tech-based theme nicely. It may seem like Skillsaw's throwing you into the deep end early here, with some high-tier demons appearing amidst the map's 150 enemies, but if you keep your head and remember to always investigate waterfalls, you'll be fine. Bad Reception is a buoyant opener with a MIDI that glitters and combat that rocks. Oh, one other thing you might notice, the chain gunners don't drop chain guns. Grade A. Difficulty D. Map 2, no rush. About 5 seconds into this level is when you'll realize that super imps are not to be f***ed with. Mixed in with hit scanners and positioned correctly, their speedy fireballs can really brutalize you. It's almost like playing with fast monsters. That said, no rush will condition you, that's what it's for. And within a death or two, you'll be on Valiant's tempo.
Not quite my tempo. It's all good. No worries. Here we go.
The super chain gun helps with that. Say hello to your new best friend. The super chain gun is the only modified weapon you'll acquire in Valiant, but it's the only one you'll need. Capable of melting mancubi, perforating pain elementals, and evaporating low-level foes with ease, the SCG is a game-changer. In my book, it's worth Valiant's price of admission all by itself. Grade B+, difficulty C+. Map 3, Tears of Pain. This quickie is more or less an expo for the super chain gun. When paired with its shotgun counterpart, you're unstoppable. The title Tears of Pain are definitely being cried by demons. And would you look at that? Skillsaw's been punning again. You know what? This is an intervention. You're a pun addict, Skillsaw, and I'll prove it to you by keeping a running pun count in this episode. Tears of Pain doesn't bring anything new to the table visually, but I love a good power fantasy every once in a while. Grade A-, difficulty D-. Map 4, Moonlit Stroll. Easily the best showcase of natural beauty in episode 1, Moonlit Stroll gives Carnage a peaceful backdrop. Grab the rocket launcher and hit this button to unleash a perfect opportunity to indulge in the super chain gun's destructive capabilities. The blue key will get you into the base, and that's where you'll meet... the Arachnorbs. Oh boy. So Arachnorbs are flying octopus brains that shoot plasma at you in triplets. They're about as durable as pinkies, and they tend to flock, which is bad news. But here's the freaky thing. When you kill an Arachnotron in Valiant, there's a 50% chance that the brain will detach from the legs and keep attacking you. The change is so significant that I encourage getting in the habit of firing extra rockets at Arachnotrons to ensure they don't eject, squirm away, and screw you over later. Now the reason I digress is, there are two pretty distinct schools of thought in Classic Doom's player base. Doom is great and never needs to be changed, and Doom is great because I can change it however I want. I'm in the former camp. I don't really do brutal Doom, weapon mods, dynamic lighting, rocket trails, mouse look. All that stuff, in my opinion, makes the game I'm playing feel less like Doom. When Valiant came along, it challenged my position. On one hand, Arachnorbs and Super Imps don't belong in Classic Doom because they don't play by the same rules. On the other hand, they're not so much different monsters as evolved versions of Doom 2's Hellish Host. They force you to play faster, a little more carefully, and just like the original Doom 2 Dream Team, they can surprise you even when you get to know them. I decided that the difference between custom elements and this doesn't feel like Doom anymore is custom elements only embellish on sensations that the classic games already give you. It's tremendously difficult to calibrate this kind of thing, but Skillsaw manages to do so successfully and boldly. His is one of the only megawads I've seen make identity-defining edits to its bestiary and weapon that don't overcompensate or feel obligatory. Whew, that was a long one. So, Moonlit Stroll is a romp. It looks excellent, there's never a dull moment, and the Arachnorb's debut will stick in your head. Grade A, difficulty C. Map 5, Aggravator. Run for your life! Aggravator is a decisive uptick in difficulty. It's rife with hit scanners and teleport traps and doesn't give you many corners to cower behind. The secret plasma rifle is a godsend if you can find it. Add shootable switches that look like this to your list of things to keep an eye out for. I wouldn't blame you for thinking these maps are starting to bleed together from an aesthetic standpoint, but it's hard to care about that when I'm running and gunning and jamming to the MIDI. Valiant had me at map 1, but Aggravator was where I went. Can this guy even make a bad level? Grade A, difficulty B-. Map 6, Engineering Disaster. This is how you do a city level. Engineering Disaster is the crown jewel of episode 1, and that's saying a lot. It retains the first 5 levels' hectic pace, keeping the player on the run, but also giving them room to explore and take in the impressive scenery. It's the prettiest level so far by a sight. A flooded city slowly being reclaimed by nature. This crumbling highway bridge is a particularly nice touch. Most city levels are unfun to move around in, often restricting your access to certain areas until you get the right keys, but Skillsaw avoids this issue by locking up only the exit. The whole city is your playground. I also appreciate the liberal access to elevators and rooftops. It makes dealing with imps and other enemies with high ground much fairer. Make sure you gear up before tackling this spider cave. Mama Spider's kind of a pushover, but her children can put up a fight if you're under-equipped. This Arachnorb swarm at the end is a hoot if you saved your BFG ammo. Engineering Disaster is incredibly entertaining, one of Valiant's highlights, and one of my personal favorites. Grade A+. Difficulty B-. Map 7, The Mancubian Candidate. So how do you end a Crackerjack episode like this? Why, by taking a 20-year-old done-to-death gimmick and putting a completely original spin on it, of course. Your instructions are simple. Don't let the Mancubus die, whether by your own hand, by accident, or by infighting. If he bites it, you'll be answering to 16 archfiles, who are free to teleport in when Doom 2's hard-coded Map 7 Mancubus death mechanic kicks in. The problem is, the Mancubian candidate is an ungrateful cuss. The further you progress, the harder it becomes to defend him, because he's got a clear view of you for the entire second half of the level, and won't hesitate to lob poorly aimed fireballs everywhere, which have a high chance of inciting infighting with cacodemons, revenants, chain gunners, and in the worst cases, arachnotrons and orbs. I've died for this stupid Mancubus more than I care to admit, sacrificing my personal safety so much that I've only triggered the archfile trap maybe once. Find all the keys, and you can hit this switch to blow up the archfiles, allowing you to safely assassinate the son of a bitch. The map concludes with a random cyberdemon showdown made slightly trickier by the lighting, and taking this portal ends the episode. The Mancubian candidate is highly innovative and enjoyable to boot. Grade A, difficulty C+. Map 8, Bushwhacked. Yeah, the episode title is a little corny, but you won't be laughing long. Bushwhacked starts heated and demands some death-defying parkour and acrobatics if you want to arm yourself and stay alive. This tightrope walk through chain gun fire and a blanket of Mancubi fireballs is ferocious, and the final room is a blistering cocktail of pain elementals, arachnorbs, and revenants. The difficulty hike here is substantial. Bushwhacked sets the aesthetic tone for the episode, turning the sky and water blood red, and incorporates more demonic decorations into its architecture. It's a fine level, and very intense. Grade B+, difficulty B. Map 9, 14 Angrier Archfiles. This spiritual sequel to Vanguard's 13 Angry Archfiles showcases some imaginative, archy-centric fight design, and sets the action in a moody, metal mountain temple. Unfortunately for you, Archfiles aren't the only flame boys you'll have to deal with in this level. Meet the Pyro Knight. He replaces the Hell Knight and is much, much scarier, both in terms of appearance and offensive capabilities. He throws lightning-fast projectiles and bursts which can decimate your health in a hurry, but he's also more prone to infighting than your average grunt, which is good because he's a champ at it. As for the level at large, I think its episodic format slows the pacing down a bit, but the encounters themselves are great. This cave with the columns and damaging floors borrows an idea from Vanguard and makes it harder. This fight where you're pinned between two raising and lowering platforms full of hit scanners and archfiles is very clever, because if you don't kill the archies quickly enough, they can resurrect everything when they dip below your line of sight, and getting Using a rocket launcher from this huge cavern doesn't spray any arch files on you, but it's still cool. Also, shout out to this very hidden secret, which doubles as an outstanding Doom 2 reference. Grade, A-. Difficulty, B. Map 10, Candle Cove. Probably the first map in Valiant I have any sort of problem with. Candle Cove is, first and foremost, lovely to look at. It's cozy, color-coordinated, and lovingly detailed, set to a fittingly twilight MIDI, courtesy of Jimmy Paddock. I have to wonder, is this map so mean because it's so beautiful, or is that just a coincidence? Arachnorbs start to become a serious problem in Candle Cove. Unlike arachnotrons, they don't make loud mechanical noises when they move around, so they have a habit of sneaking up on you or floating too far above your head for you to see them, and then peppering you with plasma, which hurts like a bitch. The blood also hurts you in this level, which gets especially irritating once you run out of rad suits, and if you don't know about the arch files that spawn in when you grab the red key, you're looking at a drawn-out fight on damaging floor with a lot of resurrected enemies and a dwindling ammo pool. And this fight near the end with the cyber demon in a flesh pit, I just don't get. Weirdly, there's another pit right next to it with armor and a soul sphere that you could easily pass up thinking it's a trap, and then be forced to deal with this. It's an uncharacteristically uncool gesture for Skillsaw. All in all, I'm gonna have to give Candle Cove a B, with a difficulty of A-. Map 11. Yesterday's Insanity. This map is an unrelenting pressure cooker, holy cow. You're stuck in a stone compound, floating on a lake of damaging blood, surrounded by imps, mancubi, and pyronites flinging all kinds of nastiness at you, and the compound is fully garrisoned and wired with traps. If you come across a prison block, expect those cells to spring open. If you come across keys, handle with care. Though it's a pretty overwhelming playthrough for first-timers, Yesterday's Insanity can be reliably exploited with a few secrets, the most significant of which will telefrag all the pyronites and give you a BFG, at which point you can relax a bit. I like this map. It encourages improvisation and harkens back to the freeform action of episode 1. Grade A-, difficulty B+. Map 12, Bane Capital. Valiant's equivalent of a speed map, Bane Capital is smaller, leaner, and less aesthetically minded than most of this episode, condensing a lot of combat into a relatively short time. The low monster count and lack of distinctive landmarks make this probably the most forgettable level so far, though this double archfile surprise always makes me jump, and the ending, a crossfire of imps, chain gunners, and pyronites, is a real bruiser. Grade B, difficulty B. Map 13, the Netweaver. Either Bane Capital was the prototype for the Netweaver, or vice versa, because the two are genetically linked somehow for sure. Their shared style is comparable to Plutonia's map 12, with a bit more natural scenery. Prison bars, metal, wood, and blood. The Netweaver is considerably more spread out than most of the episode, and less stressful than Engineering Disaster, which makes comparable use of verticality and space. There are plenty of missable pockets of ammo, guns, and monsters down in the blood trenches, but Skillsaw places doubles of the SSG, rocket launcher, and plasma in case you miss them. I highly encourage you to find the secret so you can get your hands on a BFG. Thank me later. The Netweaver wraps up Valiant's second worst episode, yep, you heard that right, on an unexpectedly agreeable note. Grade B+, difficulty B-. Map 14, Implosion. Implosion is my most played Valiant map. Sometimes I'll boot it up in the middle of doing something unrelated to Doom, beat it, and go about my day. It's an instant hit of fun, so infectious and entertaining it feels illegal. Implosion is like explosive barrel pornography. I'm talking more barrels than barrels of fun, and coupled with an early super chain gun, it makes for one of the most satisfying Doom experiences I've ever had. And the music, I don't know how you do it, Stu. Perhaps the most memorable part of Implosion is the introduction of the Suicide Bomber. I'm not sure if this is by design, but he's definitely the funniest custom enemy I've ever come across in Doom. I mean, come on, it's a buff dude with a stick of dynamite running at you, screaming his bloody head off. Like, are they even zombies, or just random bald guys that volunteered to chase Doom Guy around with explosives? Anyway, don't let them touch you, because you probably won't survive the blast. Grade plus. Difficulty C+. Map 15. Screams aren't a crime. Yet. Just when I'm starting to run out of words to describe how exciting and fast-paced this megawad is, we get to Screams Aren't a Crime Yet, arguably the most exciting and fast-paced level in the megawad. Choked with almost 500 enemies, including 300 hit scanners and 34 suicide bombers, this slime factory features one of Valiant's most memorable moments and the bloodiest 30 seconds of Doom I've ever seen. Super Chain Gun's finest hour, and truly earns this level its use of perhaps the best Lee Jackson MIDI. Forget Hell Revealed. Going down the fast way belongs to this map. During this climactic chain gunner convention, take advantage of the blur spheres and remember to find three optional switches to access the secret exit. Guys, you gotta play this one for yourselves. It's as fun as Doom gets. Grade A+. Difficulty B. Map 31. Cyber War 7734. A near-perfect secret level, Cyber War 7734 sports Valiant's highest enemy count and a visual style completely unlike anything in the Megawad. You're caught between two futuristic war zones, an extraterrestrial tech base and some kind of computer-generated combat simulation, I think. The arcadey, colorful data world is such a departure from your typical Doom locale that I can't help but be charmed, and I like the scrolling hologram text that's stupid enough to taunt you while you plow through the level. Nice Romero reference, by the way. Gameplay-wise, Cyber War is slaughter with a safety net. Those Skillsaw chucks hundreds of monsters at you at a time, he's also kind enough to gift you a whopping 18 supercharges, 11 megaspheres, and 8 invulnerabilities, not to mention a heap of armor, rockets, and cells. Oddly enough, for all its multitudes, Cyber War contains zero archviles. I know I'm starting to sound like a broken record, but I have to shout out the MIDI again, it's too good. From Speed of Doom originally, but I heard it here first. As secret levels go, Cyber War 7734 hits the spot. If you're wondering why 7734, think back to grade school. At least it wasn't 5318008. Grade A, difficulty A. Map 32, Ghosts of the Old Kingdom. Had potential. Ghosts of the Old Kingdom is a curveball of a concept map, an ancient ruin with a twist. The gimmick is, once you step foot in this parallel gray world, all the monsters are ghosts. As in, fuzzy, like specters, not ghost monsters like in Hell Revealed Map 26. It's pretty hard to see, but I'm fighting ghost revenants and specters in this clip, and here I'm taking on 8 ghost archviles. Before you panic, they have half their normal hit points, a really high pain chance, and they only get released one at a time. Doesn't making them easy to kill kind of defeat the purpose of turning them invisible? Sure, it's a cool idea, but I don't think Skillsaw committed to it enough. By the way, say hello to the Super Mancubus, who debuted in the last map but didn't distinguish himself. He fires twice as many projectiles as a normal Mancubus in a wide spread, and looks like he just crawled out of the sewers after about 20 years. Ghosts of the Old Kingdom is a neat experiment, but I'm glad it's optional. Grade B-, difficulty B-. Map 16, Toxic Traverse. Toxic Traverse is a pretty breezy map for being a polluted, trap-riddled, demon-infested industrial park. Once again, Skillsaw's work with natural environments deserves commendation here. I especially like the scraggly trees that peek out over the craggy horizon. The action is noticeably lower key than in map 15, but Toxic Traverse does have a few dirty tricks up its sleeve. Thankfully, you'll get a fire hose just in time to deal with this pile of pyro knights who want their key back, but save some cells so you don't get sandwiched at the top of these stairs. As a rule of thumb, don't be stingy with rockets, expect the unexpected, and if you want to pick on the kamikaze guarding the exit, don't get overconfident. Grade A-, difficulty B. Map 17, Precipice. As you plunge deeper into the plant, you'll notice Skillsaw's preoccupation with grinding industrial layouts deepening. The abundance of narrow walkways, platforming, secrets, and hurt floors make a case for Precipice being a chasm homage, but it's thankfully still Valiant violent. Hitting all four switches in this poison-filled levee will summon a bunch of super mancubi, making an already chaotic fight even more so. And if you get to the end of the level and find you're missing almost 100 kills, have a look in that poison levee again, and you'll find a teleporter nub that will take you to a secret area with, quite a few suicide bombers. I don't love this crusher platforming sequence near the end, but it fits the theme and looks snazzy, so I'll deal with it. Grade B+, difficulty B. Map 18, Crush Depth. Crush Depth doesn't just knock it out of the park, it hits the cover off the ball. We've made it to the heart of the Project Valiant plant, a gargantuan metal stronghold lodged in a mountain core that chugs along to the beat of an excellent MIDI, a rare collaboration between Jimmy Paddock and Stuart Rinn. Am I dreaming? There are so many noteworthy fights in this level. This battle of attrition with a platoon of pyro knights, a spider demon doubleheader, the plus sign arena where you gotta shoot switches to crush your foes and escape, and the ending. If you're the kind of person that habitually checks the monster count at the beginning of every level, you may have noticed that Crush Depth starts off with 118 enemies already dead. Well, here they are at the ending. What's the worst that could happen? 6 archviles, however many resurrected enemies, and a whole lot of crushers, knee-deep in green shit. What a way to end the episode. I think it was wise of Skillsaw to pad out this episode with the secret levels. By keeping it to 5 toxic levels, I think he kept the theme fresh and didn't have to stretch as much for new ideas. Grade A. Difficulty B+. Thou art annihilation? Ugh. Map 19. The Popes of Rome. The Popes of Rome? Vanguard veterans will get familiar vibes right away. The red patterned carpet and that orange rocky texture bring back memories of maps 11 and 12. Don't waste your time with the four cyber popes, just run around, hit switches, and keep stirring the pot. Eventually you'll have a set of weapons, a blue key, and everything will be dead. Well, almost everything. If you don't find this secret plasma rifle, the map's 13 super mancubi won't get released, and without them, you likely won't have enough ammo to deal with the remaining cyber demons. My first time around, I exited without finding the secret, very annoyed, but knowing about it nowadays doesn't really make the level more fun to play. Catch an ill-timed pope rocket, or get pinned by a horde of super imps and it's over. I guess it's a novel idea to open an episode with an infight map, but it kinda rubs me the wrong way. Grade, B-. Difficulty, B-. Map 20, Swept into Immolation. Talk about a hot start. No, really, the titular immolation doesn't just refer to the lava. The map is also crawling with archviles. For a while, it's going to be a scramble for weapons, but things get easier when you find the SCG in this fissure. Swept into Immolation is markedly harder than what's come before. It's not afraid to punish you with big ambushes and punctuates more fights with archviles than usual, which is saying something. Like this yellow skull switch fight. I know my health was too low, but close quarters imps, revenants, a pyronite, and an archvile? Just waste the archie as quick as you can, climb the altar to get a secret megasphere, and dust them from outside the building. My favorite part of the level is definitely this insane fire canyon fight. It's kind of good-naturedly brutalizing. Very Skillsaw. Grade, A-. Difficulty, A-. Map 21, Skindustrial Zone. The aesthetic pivot point of the episode, I'd call Skindustrial Zone a one-joke premise, but it's not really a joke. I mean, the walls are covered in human skin.
I swear you would be of more use to me if I skinned you and turned your skin into a lampshade, or fashioned you into a piece of high-end luggage. I can even add you to my collection!
I don't have a lot to say about this one. It's short, underpopulated, and feels like Bane Capital, except less efficient with space. Most of the fights feel obligatory, rehashed, or just plain easy, with a notable exception being this archvile sextuplet. You can use these explosive barrels to thin them out, but blow up too many, and they're more likely to outmaneuver you. This map needed more fights like this. If I had to guess, I'd say Skindustrial Zone was a last-minute addition or a reworking of an older level. Love the music, though. Grade, B-. Difficulty, C+. Map 22, Spiraling into Nether. First things first, hats off to Skillsaw's aesthetic chops. This flesh and metal molten voidscape looks spectacular. It does melt my computer a little though, and from a design perspective it's much less ambitious. You'll need to clear out three branching pathways to acquire three keys, but only one of them culminates in a noteworthy fight. This lava pit with the red key always gives me a run for my money. It's the part of the map I look forward to most. The rest gets lost in the nether of my memory, so to speak. All I know is, if you marathon Valiant, it's around this point that you'll be thinking to yourself, enough is enough with these damned arachnorms. Grade, B+, difficulty, B. Map 23, Genocide Motor. It's not deja vu, it's just continuity. Genocide Motor is a more non-linear rewrite of Spiraling into Nether. Its encounters are more spaced out, but more aggravating pound for pound. This map is a distinct John Romero flavor, with its out-of-the-way secrets that you'll need to take a dip in damaging liquids for, limited footing, and check out this yellow key fight. Pinkies, arachnotrons, mancubi, precious little wiggle room, and a cyber demon all the way in the back there. Looks hopeless, right? Wrong. Ignore everything, run for the teleporter, and you'll telefrag some of the spiders. Do this again, and you'll fry the rest and the cyber demon. Very clever, and very impish. The only other fight I think back on fondly is this red key arena with the timed lowering walls, which feels like a precursor to Ancient Aliens. By Valiant's exceptional standards, Genocide Motor is ho-hum. Grade, B. Difficulty, B. Map 24, None More Merciless. This is it. The only map in Valiant that legitimately kinda sucks. None More Merciless is an ungainly potpourri of caves, castles, flesh, tech, lava, stuff from Vanguard, and whatever the hell this opening room is. Some kind of ugly metal honeycomb full of irreverently placed hit scanners and cacodemons and arachnorbs who are really starting to piss me off. There's exactly one good fight in this map, and that's the battle for the yellow key in front of the Hieronymus Bosch painting. Archviles and revenants in the central hub, imps on both sides, and a couple of pyronites ready to rock up and wreck you if you take too long dispatching the rest. That's it. The rest of the map is so dickish, unfocused, and forgettable that I have to assume it was Skillsaw's burnout map, the kitchen sink into which he threw just enough ideas to make a finale out of, then shipped as is. It's the kind of redundancy and lack of freshness that he avoided in episode 3 by only doing 5 maps and one theme. The one prominent lowlight in my mind is this part where you cross a bridge and it sinks, making you run barefoot through lava to a teleporter that takes you to this coverless lava fall area, where like 8 arachnorps are hidden just below your eye level, so you run past them, wake them up, and they all shoot you in the back at once. I was stacked and flush with cells going in, and I still got shellacked. I mean, I'm also a bad Doom player, but— Oh yeah, I almost forgot about the Cybruiser. He's a metal hell knight that's immune to splash damage and fires rockets at you. He's not too bad. Anyway, grade, C-, difficulty, B+. Map 25, The Eagle Has Landed. All right, we finally made it to the moon episode. I'm not sure where this fits into the Skillsaw cinematic universe exactly, but his 2011 mini-wad Lunatic is also set on the moon, and map 11 of Ancient Aliens gives it a cameo as well. This marks the return of the freewheeling Valiant from episodes 1 and 3 that we know and love. By this point, I feel defenseless without a super chain gun, but the level makes you do without it, mostly. Sharp-eyed secret hunters can also get themselves a rocket launcher, much needed for the closing sequence. All in all, the Eagle has landed as a snappy opener, not nearly as hard as you'd expect. Grade B+, difficulty C. Map 26, Blast Wave. First of all, holy shit, that's an unfriendly start. Two cybruisers and a suicide bomber. Second of all, holy shit, this music is awesome. Blast Wave leaves you open to constant attacks from all sides, so stay on the move. Keep two eyes on the cybruisers especially. Disrespect them and you're dead meat. No super shotgun on this map, sadly. Oh well, I guess we'll just have to be content with... I won't say it replaces the super shotgun, but I've never seen another weapon come as close. Blast Wave is high-octane stuff and goes down easy. Grade A-, difficulty B. Map 27. Rocket Zone 2. If I had to recommend someone a single level that best captured the spirit of Valiant, it would be Rocket Zone 2. I know it's a reworked Lunatic level, but who cares? The visuals are to die for, the fights are kinetic and upbeat, and the music instills you with a sense of pre-liftoff excitement. I love the high contrast lighting in this episode, the best example of which comes in the form of these space shuttles and their long shadows. This whole scene is so infectiously neat. The stars, the big blue Earth, rockets ready for launch. Skillsaw absolutely nailed it. Rocket Zone's no slouch in the action department either. I love this ominous scene of slaughter that foreshadows a rollicking ambush at the checkpoint, the hailfire of projectiles that greet you at the spaceport, and of course, this triple archfile ambush by the space shuttles. What, did you think I was gonna say the final countdown? Needs to be said, but the final countdown is a legendary event of a battle, a delirious adrenaline rush that will leave you overjoyed. I'm not sure if it's a meme or a sincere attempt at a dramatic moment, but I guess it's a little of both. Wonderful fight, wonderful map. I'll love it till the day I die. Grade A+, difficulty B+. Map 28, A Light Bridge Too Far. Quite possibly the trickiest map in the Megawad, A Light Bridge Too Far is packed to the gills with Valiant exclusive monsters. 41 Arachnorbs, 16 Super Mancubi, 14 Cybruisers, 10 Kamikazes, 9 Pyro Knights, and a Pinky in a Pear Tree. That the monsters are often given superior positioning makes things even worse, and damage avoidance can become something of a balancing act. The ambushes toward the end can get exceptionally crazy unless you know about them and just run away, like I do, but there's no fleeing the massive gantlet of imps and arachnotrons at the end. Nope, for that we find the secret invincibility. Aesthetically, Light Bridge is episode 5 par excellence. The light bridges themselves are a nifty bit of mapping wizardry and look great besides. It's another outstanding level, another outstanding MIDI, and another A, with a difficulty of A. Map 29, Redshift. Oh, this could have been a great one. Maybe even the best, but I think Skillsaw pulled some punches. Don't get me wrong, Redshift will torch you if you disrespect it, but it's just not equal to the penultimate slot. It's easier than map 28, and less intrepid than map 27. Redshift showers you with power-ups and ammunition, and the enemy count is padded out with over 250 super imps. There is one pretty ridiculous fight, which gives me an idea of what this level would have looked like if Skillsaw really took the gloves off. Take this teleporter and hold onto your hat. I wouldn't call it a flop, but Redshift is a little disappointing. Again, Valiant standards. Grade B+, difficulty B+. Map 30, Electric Nightmare. Boss fight time. This is about as hype as a map 30 prep room can get. The floor is littered with excess ammo, monster pods pumped full of Valiant are priming for launch all around you, and the music is dramatic as hell. When you're ready, take the teleporter to meet the one behind it all, the Super Vile. Q You're goddamn right there's gonna be a music change. Yeah, the super vile's kind of an asshole. He seems faster than the garden variety. Archie has 2 cyber demons worth of hit points, and his flame attack hits you in 4 waves, so there's the initial blast, and then 1, 2, 3. Those aftershocks will hit you if you're in his line of sight at any point during the attack. The fight gets more chaotic as more enemies get released into the arena. If I were you, I wouldn't waste too much ammo on them because the Super Archie will just bring him back. If you can hang on to the last wave, he's more likely to be distracted. The entire boss fight is a big catch-22 of needing to be constantly on the move to avoid crony projectiles, and needing to stay put because the Super Vile's constantly trying to zap you. I can't say it's my favorite map in this Megawad, it's pretty rage-inducing actually, but it's hands down the best boss stage I've seen in Doom. Grade A-, difficulty A. So, around the time I first played Valiant, close to a year ago at this point, I was already starting to get jaded when it came to Doom. I was spoiled by Eviternity, had gotten my ass thoroughly kicked by Hell Revealed, Scythe, and their sequels, and wasn't finding my favorite custom wads as replayable as the classics. Learning new levels was draining, and the game was starting to lose its sense of fun. Valiant single-handedly resuscitated my love for Doom. It's a perfect combination of fresh, accessible gameplay, originality, visual beauty, and killer music. There's scarcely a dull moment in the Megawad, and I think you'd be hard-pressed to name me a set of levels more ebullient, fun-loving, and downright badass. That Skillsaw made this more or less all on his own is a minor miracle, and that he followed it up with Ancient Aliens the next year makes him 100% Doom Hall of Fame eligible. Valiant is my favorite Megawad of all time. Final grade, A+. It's tough to say whether or not it's harder than other Megawads in its weight class like Back to Saturn X due to the gameplay modifications. Just to be safe, I'm gonna give it a B. Now for my Dean's List. Valedictorian? Map 27, Rocket Zone 2. Salutatorian? Map 15, Screams Aren't a Crime Yet. Class President? Map 28, A Light Bridge Too Far. And the dunce cap goes to Map 24, None More Merciless. Listing what's not on the honor roll would be easier than reading the whole thing, and I don't want to drag this episode out any further, so here it is. The ones with stars all could have been valedictorians of lesser megawads. Thank you very much for watching, and please feel free to share your thoughts on the wad down below. I'd love to hear what you think, and I'll heart your comments to let you know I've read them. This is Mount Pain 27, and I'll see you in the next episode of Dean of Doom.